In this presentation, we'll be discussing von Willebrand's disease. In this discussion of von Willebrand's disease, I will review a case, talk about the physiology of von Willebrand factor itself, talk about von Willebrand disease, the types of von Willebrand's disease, the diagnostic workup, as well as the treatment of this disease. This case is of a 70-year-old gentleman who presents with increasing nocturia to his primary care physician. Primary care physician orders a PSA, which is elevated, and the patient is referred to urology for a scheduled prostate biopsy. Prior to the biopsy, a pre-procedure workup reveals a previous medical history of von Willebrand's disease, which was diagnosed in 2005. Also of note, patient has had recurrent sinus polyps. Patient's previous surgical history includes a tonsillectomy in 1943, a sinus polypectomy associated with heavy bleeding in 2002. No workup was pursued at that time. A repeat sinus polypectomy in 2005, complicated again by bleeding. Workup of this bleeding at this time led to the diagnosis of von Willebrand's disease. In order to understand the underlying state of von Willebrand's disease, one must understand the biology of von Willebrand factor. Here is a crystalline structure of the factor itself. This factor is produced by endothelial cells and megakaryocytes. It is produced as a monomer through cellular manipulation. These monomers are then bound to other monomers, forming dimers. These dimers then bind to other dimers, forming multimers. This multimer is the functional state of the factor. High molecular weight von Willebrand factor multimers are the most hemostatically and biologically active. In order to understand the role of von Willebrand's factor in adhesion and aggregation, one must understand the physiology of this factor. Here we have a blood vessel with endothelial cells along its lining. These endothelial cells are damaged, exposing subendothelial collagen fibers. Once these collagen fibers are exposed, von Willebrand's factor in the serum binds to these collagen fibers. Once this factor is bound, it then binds to platelets through the GP1B or glycoprotein 1B receptor. This complex forms the initial adhesion of platelets to damaged endothelium. Once von Willebrand's factor binds the glycoprotein 1B, it induces glycoprotein 2B3A expression on these platelets as well. Once this protein is expressed, further von Willebrand factor binds to it, thus allowing for binding of further platelets, leading to aggregation of platelets to the damaged endothelium. Von Willebrand factor is also importantly associated with factor VIII. Specifically, von Willebrand factor has a D3 binding domain that binds to factor VIII. This binding domain stabilizes factor VIII in the serum, and thus patients who have von Willebrand's disease and thus low von Willebrand factor have decreased levels of factor VIII in their bloodstream. This then leads to an increased PTT. Below is a diagram of where on the von Willebrand factor monomer factor VIII binds to stabilize it. Now that we've gone over the biology and physiology of this factor, we will now delve into the von Willebrand's disease itself. Von Willebrand's disease was originally described in 1926 by a Finnish pediatrician, Dr. Erik von Willebrand. It is the most common inherited bleeding disorder. It is inherited in an autosomally dominant trait in the majority of the cases. Mutations can affect synthesis as well as the mechanism of action of the von Willebrand factor. Symptoms that can indicate an underlying disease state are easy bruising as well as prolonged bleeding, especially from mucosal surfaces. Von Willebrand's disease itself is subclassified in three subtypes. Type 1 is the most common. It results in a quantitative deficiency where you have varying degrees of decreased level of the von Willebrand factor antigen in the bloodstream. Type 2 are qualitative abnormalities, and so these are abnormalities in the function and mechanism of action of the von Willebrand factor. And type 3 are marked decreases or complete absence of von Willebrand factor itself. In addition to the traditional von Willebrand disease classifications, it is also recognized now that there is another classification known as acquired von Willebrand syndrome. This syndrome can present with acquired defects in von Willebrand factor concentration, structure, or function. It is very important to note that these individuals have no personal or family history of bleeding disorders, and it is associated with various underlying disease states. And so when present, it is important to look into other underlying diseases that may be associated with it. A thorough bleeding history needs to be taken in order to delineate the difference between acquired von Willebrand syndrome and von Willebrand disease itself. This especially is important for family history and personal history of easy bruising, prolonged bleeding from mucosal surfaces, and procedural history. Lab evaluation initially looks at a CBC as well as a PT and PTT. An isolated prolonged PTT is noted in this disease, and this is due to concomitant decrease in factor VIII, which, as it is bound to von Willebrand's factor, is decreased in its level in the bloodstream. This prolongation of PTT does correct with a one-to-one mixing study. Once von Willebrand disease is suspected, further lab evaluation is needed. This includes plasma von Willebrand factor antigen levels, as well as the plasma von Willebrand factor activity, which includes erysticetin cofactor activity, as well as a collagen binding activity. Erysticetin is actually an antibiotic that was noted to induce platelet aggregation, and it was found that this is functions through inducing von Willebrand factor activity. Also, one should evaluate factor VIII levels in the bloodstream. So going back to our case, if you will remember, the patient had no prolonged bleeding history prior to his polyp surgeries in 2002, and thus no personal history prior to age 65. He has no family history of bleeding disorders, and thus this indicates that most likely he has an acquired von Willebrand syndrome. His bleeding workup found a PTT that was prolonged at 45 seconds, a von Willebrand factor antigen level that was low at 24, a von Willebrand factor risticetin cofactor activity also low at less than 12.5, and a factor VIII level low at 22. Also, patient had an abnormal multimer pattern. Subtype diagnosis can be made for type 1, where reduced von Willebrand factor antigen is present, as well as reduced von Willebrand factor activity, looking at either the risticetin or collagen cofactor assays, also a reduced factor VIII activity. Type 2 diagnosis can be made looking at the risticetin cofactor activity to von Willebrand factor antigen ratio, with ratios being less than 0.5 to 0.7. Of note, there are four subtypes of type 2, and these can be delineated through these various different binding activity as well as multimer analysis. Type 3 is diagnosed where von Willebrand factor antigen is unmeasurable or extremely low. Risticetin cofactor activity is also very low, secondary to the antigen being low. And factor VIII also finally is low at 1 to 10% of normal. Treatment of this disease is usually initially with desmopressin or DDAVP. Desmopressin is an analog of vasopressin. When present, it induces the endothelial cells to release von Willebrand factor into the bloodstream. Also, another treatment is von Willebrand factor concentrates, or Humate-P. These are concentrates that include high molecular weight von Willebrand factor multimers. In summary, von Willebrand factor plays a very important role in platelet adhesion and aggregation at sites of vascular injury. In normal physiology, von Willebrand factor stabilizes factor VIII. Von Willebrand disease is the most common inherited bleeding disorder. There are three subtypes of von Willebrand disease leading to qualitative as well as quantitative defects in von Willebrand factor. An initial treatment for patients with von Willebrand disease who are bleeding are desmopressin and von Willebrand factor concentrates. For further reading, these are the key references to review. and I would like to thank Dr. Ara Metchin as well as Dr. Philip Blatt for their help. Thank you very much.